Good morning to everyone back there on the central time zone. I'm Tom Jones, mission specialist aboard the Space Shuttle Endeavour. We're now over the South Pacific Ocean, just southeast of New Zealand. I want to take a few minutes out of our busy schedule up here of maneuvers and science operations to tell you about our studies of global change on this mission. This mission of the Space Radar Lab aboard STS-59 on Endeavour is part of NASA's mission to planet Earth, which is a comprehensive program using the space shuttle and unmanned satellites to study the Earth as the next century begins and to understand the changes that are going on, both natural and man-made. Now, I'd like to tell you about our experiences here for the first 4 days of the flight. We've been seeing traces of both man-made and natural change. Spring is coming to the northern hemisphere. We can see the snow line retreating across Asia, and we're seeing vegetation patterns, land use changes, natural changes caused by weather and geology, like volcanoes and earthquakes. We're looking for all those kinds of phenomena. I'd like to tell you about why we're able to study global change from the space shuttle on this flight. First of all, I want to mention our vantage point up here in orbit above the Earth, what the Space Radar Lab out in the payload bay is looking for, and then give you some examples of the kinds of change that we're hoping to study on the flight. Now, our vantage point here aboard Endeavour is very important. We're about 138 nautical miles above the Earth's surface, circling the globe once about every 89 minutes. And that elevation, that altitude, gives us a horizon that's out several hundred miles from wherever we happen to be over the Earth. And that gives us the broad perspective and the ability for our sensors in the cargo bay to see a long distance and measure change in a reasonably efficient amount of time. Also, because we're in orbit, our speed is very important. Circling the Earth at 17,000 miles an hour, we're able to use our speed to let our radar out in the cargo bay, Circe-XR, create a much larger electronic antenna than would otherwise be possible. We can see finer detail on the ground because of our speed across the Earth's surface. That whole technique is called synthetic aperture radar. And also, with our pollution sensor called MAPS in the cargo bay, our speed permits us to cover the world as it rotates beneath us, and thus we can create in just 2 or 3 days a global map of carbon monoxide, a tracer gas of pollution or burning on the planet's surface. So the vantage point here is very important. Now, what kinds of changes can we see from this vantage point in low Earth orbit? Our synthetic aperture radar creates images, pictures of the ground using microwaves, which can be taken during darkness or through clouds. The MAPS carbon monoxide sensor creates a map of global pollution. It traces sources of combustion and how that trace gas, CO, spreads across the globe. Now, using those images and that pollution map, we can look at Earth's past, present, and its future. We can look back into Earth's past by noting changes in the geology of the Earth that tell us about the world's past climate. We can look at the present and take a snapshot, a baseline measurement, if you will, of the pulse of Earth's forests, cities, our production of pollution in both hemispheres, and we can also measure the ecology, the environment, and take its present temperature, if you will. And now we can look into Earth's future by flying the Space Radar Lab twice this year on STS-68 later in the year, and later a radar of this type and a similar suite of instruments could be orbited on an unmanned platform. And by measuring Earth's environment over months and years, we can see the trends on our ecosphere that would help us manage the planet in a better and more careful way.
Okay, Nancy, what we did was earlier today we recorded us doing what we're here for, which is to do a large number of maneuvers to point the radar exactly at the targets that the radar folks are interested in. And we understand from the radar people that they're getting accuracies that are far beyond their initial expectations, and the targets are showing up right in the middle of their radar swaths, and we're real happy to be able to help them do that. Here we are putting in one of the 460-some maneuvers that the ground has planned for us, and it's a real pleasure to be able to go do that and see the results like the radar folks have been showing people down there, and know that we're able to point the orbiter extremely precisely to get very specific targets within range of the radar beams from all of the equipment out in the payload bay. This is what we spend most of our time doing, and what I think you guys have been really helping us check.
We're just now coming upon Chile after passing across the coastline. And the target area for this observation is the Andes Mountains, Central Cordillera area. Dr. Isaacs is mapping the topography and studying the climate in the Central Andes Mountains. He's mapping things such as plate tectonics, or the movement of the Earth's crust in this area, as well as mudslides and other climatic events. This image is of Sicily. This is a real-time image seen exactly as the radar system aboard Endeavour records it. And now Endeavour's radar is crossing the coast of Italy. This is the most southern tip of Italy here. The Matera, Italy calibration site is located in a very flat agricultural area. And the wavy lines in the image are the former Yugoslavian territory, Eastern Europe.
Well, this is a view from one of the aft payload bay cameras showing the radar and zooming out from the cockpit over to the Earth. This was on a pass we did earlier today over Central Europe. You can see the Ku band antenna lit up there. And that's how a lot of the data that you're seeing real-time down on Earth gets down there.
Okay, Jody, we're over, we're getting close to the water here in the Labrador Sea.
Okay,
well, it looks pretty clear today.
Great, we're all listening.
We're seeing some clear areas out there and some sea ice, and there's some glare chasing just ahead of us. On the sea ice, the Chile's trying to shoot right now.
Okay, we're seeing the XR come down and see the ice looking as large floes that are breaking up.
That's exactly right. There's some very large sections and then kind of wavy-looking pieces where we can see clear water in between.
We see those right now. The leads are showing up quite clearly.
We have a video that we'll show you next, which is a view of the Earth along the across Canada, and you'll see both the Earth as viewed by the astronauts through a video downlink and the Earth as viewed by the radar. And this is coming across the screen now. You see the white areas on the right are frozen lakes. In the radar image they appear black, and the bright areas in the radar image on the left are forests. This is a time of year when thawing is occurring, and in the early part of the mission, the astronauts were calling down that all of these lakes appeared nearly completely frozen, and now today they're calling down that some of the ice is starting to break up, and so we're pretty excited about this. This means that we might capture the thaw in these high boreal forest regions.
This is a real-time image coming down from the synthetic aperture radar. The site. That is currently being tracked. Is of the Netherlands region of Flevoland. The orbiter's again moving to the southeast. This is a calibration site of high interest primarily because of its it was artificially created by the Dutch, and it allows for easy interpretation of the radar data once it's obtained here on the ground.
These are the German Alps showing up now on the radar. Now we're approaching the supersite at Oberpfaffenhofen, Germany, where the 24 locations with their active radar calibrators are set up. And the Munich airport passing right below. Oberpfaffenhofen is just outside Munich. And the Danube River now in the picture.
Before sunrise on the California coast, but the radar can see through that as the California coastline comes into view. On a northeasterly track, Endeavour will cross the coastal ranges, which are mountains that are made from various fault lines. Should also cross over the San Andreas Fault just before the San Joaquin Valley, which is coming into view, a large agricultural area. The orbiter is now crossing the Sierra Nevada to the Mammoth Mountain area, which is a backup supersite, which is on the eastern part of the Sierras. As mentioned, this is a hydrology site. The interest here is for the snow cover and the amount of snow cover in that area because of the production of water that the Sierras produce for the Southern California area.
What you're going to see in a minute is a Circe L-band image of Death Valley. Death Valley is one of what we call our super sites. In front of you, you can see the Long Valley, which is the dark area at the center of the image, and on either side, you can see the high ranges. Now, a lot of you may be familiar. We produce some similar videos for the Magellan mission. We start out here in the Cotton Ball Basin. The bright, rough surfaces that you see are salt deposits along the bottom of the valley, and also some of the rougher, rockier surfaces. Now, this is L-band, which means that the bright surfaces that you see are produced by sort of rubble-sized or medium-sized blocks. Now we're flying down through Death Valley. The smooth deposits you're seeing are some of the relatively smooth salt deposits on the floor and some of the smoother fans. Now these fans that are coming down from the sides of the valley are produced by much wetter periods in history. What we're trying to understand here at Death Valley with this radar data is what can these alluvial fans tell us about the past climate history of the Earth?
And the coastline coming into view, vision from the synthetic aperture radar as Endeavour crosses the coastline of North America up just above the state of Washington. The data take is of the Juan de Fuca Strait, which is off the coastline. And this is an oceanographic data take for the radar system. Again, it is designed to observe surface and internal waves as well as wind motion at the sea surface.
We're using 14 cameras on this flight. 35mm cameras, Hasselblad cameras, TV cameras out in the payload bay, a movie camera, and this big 4x5-inch camera. All right, now this just short clip here is far northeastern Asia on the mainland passing out to sea. And you can see on the video here the coastline of Sakhalin Island, and it's very snowy still in this part of the world as winter ends. And there is some sea ice all along the island of Sakhalin up through the Sea of Okhotsk that the radar is imaging for experiments on the penetration of the radar into the ice field. And you can see some frozen lakes and ponds in the tundra region up here. And in particular, one of the calibration sites for the radar mission to evaluate the performance of the radar beam, its strength and signal intensity, and its and the ability to aim the radar accurately is Sarabetsu, Japan. And that calibration site is coming into view right here. You can see some of the snow-capped peaks around this area of the coast, and then the street pattern there just to the northeast of Sarabetsu on the coast of Hokkaido. And there you see us passing out over the east coast of Hokkaido into the Pacific Ocean. It's a site that's of a lot of interest to a lot of people because this is an area of the Aral Sea that used to be the fourth largest body of water in the world and is now shrinking tremendously due to taking the water for agricultural irrigation of the cotton fields down in Kazakhstan. And in fact, the area just to the top of your screen there, I'm sorry, to the bottom of your screen, has a number of fishing boats that are left high and dry 30 or 40 miles from the water. It used to be an enormous commercial fishing area, but now it's drying up, and there are predictions that if things continue at the current rate of diverting the water, the whole Aral Sea will be dry by the year 2020.
This is Mission Control. These views are from Endeavour's payload bay cameras as it flies down across the southern Pacific Ocean. On this orbit, it will pass just slightly north of the tip of New Zealand.
Endeavour is on a southeasterly track now out over the Atlantic Ocean just after crossing over the coastline of the east coast of the United States. The orbiter is in a nose-forward position with the payload bay of the orbiter pointed toward Earth.
Endeavour Houston, we're live on the flight deck. Endeavour Houston, New York City sure was impressive.
We're enjoying it too, Pelomac. Yeah, Bill, we just got a beautiful pass up the Hudson River and saw West Point.
Yeah, Rich, I'm trying to tell Brent he should have gotten here just a couple minutes ago and maybe seen that other school further down the coast.
Endeavour SRL, no response, but your go for tape change on recorder 3.